Hi, welcome to Type 2 Diabetes number 10. Today we're going to talk about A1C, HbA1c, or glycated hemoglobin, or hemoglobin A1c. I don't believe there's anyone with diabetes that has not heard about A1C, right? But today we're going to see what it really means and why it sounds like a time machine, you know, your average blood sugar for the last 2 to 3 months. Now, what we already know is that we have glucose in our bloodstream, right? And when you measure your blood sugar, when you do this and check your blood sugar, you are checking the sugar in your blood that is freely moving up and down. Now, what we need to know is that sugar in your blood can also be attached to different things in your body. They can be attached to proteins, they can be attached to lipids, to DNA, you know, to different things. And when this glucose is freely, randomly attached to another molecule, it's called glycation. And why am I telling you about glycation? Because when glucose attaches to a molecule, to another molecule, without enzymes forcing them, that we call glycation, is an irreversible relationship. It's just like the way marriages are supposed to be, you know, till death do us part. I think that's how you say it, right? If glucose can be attached to different things, know that we can measure glucose anywhere in your body. We can measure them connect to some cells like your red blood cells. We can even measure them in your brain, you know, but that's kind of illegal. So we'll just use the easiest ones. Now, the most abundant cells that you have in your body are red blood cells. And each red blood cell has more than 200 million molecules called hemoglobin that transport oxygen. And when glucose attached to them, you know, till death do us part, that kind of relationship, we call them glycated hemoglobin, or HbA1c, or A1c. Now the A, hemoglobin A, the A stands for adult. And we have 1, 2, 1c, 1a, 1b. But the ones with glucose attached to them, we call them glycated hemoglobin, or A1c. And in general, if you don't have diabetes, less than 5.7% of these hemoglobins will have glucose attached to them. But for people with diabetes, they are 6.5% or more. And anything in between, 5.7 to 6.4, is what we call pre-diabetes. But now, why do we say that it's your average blood sugar for the past 2 to 3 months? Because your red blood cells only live for about 120 days before they are eaten by some white blood cells called macrophages. They actually recycle them, but they eat them first, then they recycle them. So that's why we say for the past 2 to 3 months. It's based on the life of red blood cells. But we can't say the full 120 days, because when you take a sample, even though some red blood cells might be there for 4 months, but there are other blood cells that will be younger, maybe just came yesterday or something. So the average is about 2 to 3 months, somewhere there. Now, what are some of the pros and cons of HbA1c? As I told you, this relationship is very stable. So when you take samples and you go do your test, things do not change quickly. And even patients, when they take one sample and take another one and another one, or maybe the other one the next day, it doesn't change too much because it's very stable. For example, when you measure the glucose that is here, if you eat too much, goes up, you don't eat, goes down, you didn't sleep well, goes up, you are stressed, goes up, you know, there are a lot of things that can influence your blood glucose, but does not affect A1C that much. Another very important thing is that A1C has a better correlation with diabetes complication because it measures glycated hemoglobin. And as I told you, glycation is one of the problems that lead to complications. So they're very close. If the hemoglobin in your red blood cells are glycated, different things in your blood are also glycated. That's why patients with diabetes have a hard time fighting infection. You know, in my last video about coronavirus, I told you that patients with diabetes have a higher mortality rate. This is one of the issues. So HbA1c has a very good correlation with complications. And another thing is that measurement of A1c are more standardized than, you know, the glucometers that you can just buy anywhere, and some of them are different. Now, there are also some problems with A1c because you measure the glucose inside your red blood cells. So anything, any illness that affects your red blood cells or the hemoglobin in your red blood cells will affect your A1c. Patients with anemia, for example, their A1c test will not be accurate. And another problem with A1c is that it just tells you your average blood sugar. Let's say you have an A1c of 7. Now, your average blood glucose will be around 154. But this does not tell you that it's always around 154. This will give you an average of 154, but this one will also give you an average of 154. So at the end of the day, you know your average, but you don't know your highs and your lows. Now, I'll try to answer the question about A1C goals, because different guidelines say different things. You know, 7 from ADA and maybe 7 to 8 from ACP, for example. But you need to understand that those are just numbers. They're just average. Everyone should have a different A1C. If you read the ADA guidelines in details, I'll put a table here. Less than 7 is better for some patients, and more than 7 is better for other patients. This will depend on you and your doctor, whatever you decide. For example, for those of you that are not taking medications, you're just using diet and exercise to lower your A1C, you can do it. You can lower it to normal, no problem. But if you're taking medications that can increase your risk of hypoglycemia or other complications, then you're not encouraged to go that way. Another example is, how long are you expecting to live? For example, if you still want to live for another 20, 30, 40 years, you would better go this way. But let's say you're old, you're 80 years old, and you're trying to lower your A1C. There's no point of trying to prevent the complications, because by the time you get the complications, you will be. And also, another very important thing is if patients can do it, like if they feel motivated to do it. For example, if you, for those that watch Beat Diabetes channel, I know you are very motivated. Those can go this way, but some patients are not motivated. So it's safer to get a higher goal for them because they don't know what they're doing. But if you know and you're motivated, then this way is better. Make sure you give this video a thumbs up if you liked it, and share with your friends and others that might need it. Subscribe. Have a blessed week. Bye.